welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Katie Weaver and Andrew Smith. Later, Anna Mateo presents this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
former President of the United States, Jimmy Carter, is turning 100 on October 1st. The 39th president is celebrating the century mark at his home in Plains, Georgia, where he was born in 1924. He is currently in hospice care. Carter's small southern town is much like it was when he was a boy. But America and the world overall has seen major changes over his long life. The U.S. population is almost 3 times larger than it was in 1924. America grew from about 114 million people to about 330 million today. The world population grew even faster, from 1.9 billion to more than 8.1 billion during the same period. That great increase has not reached Plains, Georgia, however. The town of 500 people in the 1920s now has closer to 600. Much of its local economy revolves around Carter, its most famous son. Jimmy Carter first ran for president in 1976 against then-president Gerald Ford. That election marked the first time the television network NBC started using a red and blue electoral map to cover the election results. The colors have since become a permanent part of the American political language. The color blue represents the Democratic Party, and red represents the Republican Party. In 1924, there was no Amazon to order goods online. But Americans could order a build-it-yourself house from a Sears catalog for $2,025. That amount was a little below the average worker's yearly earnings. There was no superstore like Walmart, but people could buy bread, milk, and other things at small local general stores. Prohibition, the ban on making and drinking alcohol, had been national law for 4 years when Carter was born. He was 9 when it ended. The former president and his late wife, Rosalyn, were not known as big drinkers. They usually served wine as the single kind of alcoholic drink at White House state dinners, mainly to save money. Other kinds of alcohol would increase the cost of the events. But Carter's brother, Billy, was known for his beer drinking. When Carter became president, Billy sold his name to a beer manufacturer to produce Billy Beer. News sources reported that Billy Carter received a $50,000 yearly payment for use of his name from one brewer. That would be about $215,000 in today's economy. The 19th Amendment that extended voting rights to women went into effect in 1920, 4 years before Carter's birth. And the Voting Rights Act that widened voting rights to Black Americans was passed in 1965. Now, Carter is set to vote by mail for Vice President Kamala Harris, says his grandson, Jason Carter. He added that his grandfather is excited about the chance to see Harris make history. If elected, Harris would become the first female and the first person of South Asian ancestry to lead the United States. Jimmy Carter was born in a period of isolationism, protectionism, and white Christian nationalism in the U.S. In 1922, Congress enacted taxes on imports, called tariffs, to help U.S. manufacturers. After stock market losses in 1929, lawmakers added more tariffs to help farmers. 5 months before Carter was born, President Calvin Coolidge signed the Immigration Act of 1924. The law created the U.S. Border Patrol and sharply limited immigration, permitting mostly just Western Europeans to enter. Asians were barred from the country completely. Congress said the law was meant to preserve the ideal of U.S. homogeneity. The militant white supremacist group, Ku Klux Klan, held large marches in Washington in 1925 and 1926 to gather support. A century later, Republican presidential candidate Donald Trump is promising to order the largest deportation effort in U.S. history if he wins office. Trump is also calling for tariffs on all goods coming to America. I'm Katie Weaver.
People are driving from hours away to buy cookies at Loschel's Bakery outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And orders for its red and blue cookies are coming in from as far away as the American state of Alaska. They come to buy the 10-centimeter round cookies in blue and white showing the name of the Democratic candidate, Kamala Harris. Or they want the red and white cookies with the name of the Republican candidate, Donald Trump. These are not your everyday cookies. At Loschel's Bakery, the sale of each Harris 2024 or Trump 2024 cookie counts as a vote for the candidate. The candidate with the most cookies sold is considered the winner of its cookie poll. The sale of cookies and the cookie poll began in the 2008 presidential election as a joke between the bakery owners and their customers. The cookie poll correctly predicted Barack Obama as the winner in 2008 and 2012, and Trump as the winner in 2016. But in 2020, more customers bought cookies named after Trump, who lost that year's election to Joe Biden. Kathy Loschel is one of the bakery's owners. She said the cookie poll is meant to be fun. It's definitely not scientific. It's just a way to take the pressure off with what is going on with the election, Loschel added.
Helen Moran recently bought Trump cookies on her 82nd birthday. Moran said she bought each time Trump ran for election. "He's my sweetheart. I love him so much," she said. Loschel said the bakery is selling even more cookies this year than in 2020. "These cookies are being shipped all over the United States right now, so much so that they're on back order. So we're about 3 to 4 weeks back," Loschel said. It helps that Loschel's bakery is in the moderate and heavily populated suburbs of Philadelphia. The bakery is also in the battleground state of Pennsylvania, where support for Trump and Harris is evenly split among voters. Whichever candidate wins more battleground states will likely win this year's election. The sale of Trump cookies may have increased after he shared a story about the cookie poll on social media. As of September 24th, Trump was leading Harris in cookie sales, 12,558 to 889, a far bigger lead than real election polls of likely voters have found. I'm Andrew Smith.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. A woman in Portland, Oregon, started her daily exercise habit with one activity: walking her dog. Lindsay Key then added movements to this daily activity. Before leaving on the walk, she did some standing stretches. On her return, she did other exercises, such as jumping jacks. Over time, Key added more exercises around the dog walk. She said adding exercises to an existing activity took the pressure off of creating a whole new daily exercise. And now, more than a year later, she consistently exercises around the dog walk. Key said, "I've found it to be really effective in helping me be consistent with things that I really want to do." What Key did is called habit stacking. Writer S. J. Scott created this term for his 2014 book of the same name. The idea behind habit stacking is to attach something you want to start doing to something you already do every day. A common example is flossing your teeth after brushing them. However, you can use habit stacking in many areas of your daily life. Key, for example, places her vitamins next to the coffee machine. This helps her remember to take them every morning. Exercise experts say habit stacking is especially helpful if you are trying to increase exercise time. Dana Santis is a movement expert who has trained more than 50 professional sports teams. She combines exercise habits with personal health care. For example, Santis does push-ups before every shower, and she does leg exercises while brushing her teeth. She says that her electric toothbrush makes a sound every 30 seconds to remind her to brush different teeth. But she uses the reminder to change her exercises. "It's perfect," she added. 2 minutes of exercise may not get you in shape, but experts say every little bit helps. Experts at the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention suggest getting 150 minutes of moderate activity, like a fast walk, every week. Or you could also get 75 minutes of very energetic activity, like jogging, every week. The health experts also suggest 2 days a week of strength training. Most people find keeping new habits difficult. And while habit stacking is not a perfect solution, it does help with one barrier: decision making. Gretchen Rubin is the writer of Better Than Before: Mastering the Habits of Our Everyday Lives. She said habit stacking is one of the best ways to start and keep new habits. The technique helps to remove the barrier of deciding when or if to do something. Rubin shared a story of her college days. To help her stay active, she would only shower if she had exercised that day. She suggested combining the new, or what she calls shaky behavior, with something you have to do or deeply want to do. So you have to do the shaky habit before you get to the strong habit, Rubin said. If she wants to listen to a podcast, her strong habit, she must do it while exercising on a running machine. For her, this will strengthen her shaky habit. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
Ana Mateo is here now to talk more about that report. Hi, Ana. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for inviting me.
I think it's pretty common for most people to have a hard time creating and sticking to new habits. Can you explain how the idea of habit stacking might help a person?
With habit stacking, you connect, or stack, a new habit onto an existing habit.
What is an example?
Let's say you want to take vitamins every morning. You could prepare them in advance and keep them near your coffee machine or teapot. So right after you make your morning drink, it is easy to also take your vitamins.
How can this work with exercise?
Well, you can add exercises to something you already do every day. For example, taking a walk.
All right. That's so helpful, Ana. Thanks for joining me today, and thank you for that report.
Thanks for having me. I really enjoy talking about this topic. My name is Ana Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Being in Washington helps Ana learn about U.S. history. There are many memorials and monuments in the city that connect to important people and events in the country's past. As we mentioned in a previous lesson of the day, a memorial is something that pays respect to the memory of the lives of people who have died.
And a monument is a large structure, usually made out of stone, built to remind people of a famous person or a famous historical event. Lessons 25 and 26 of the series show Anna learning about U.S. history at the monuments and memorials.
Near the Lincoln Memorial, a man who is interested in U.S. history runs into Anna by accident. Let's listen.
Hello from Washington, D.C. This city has many monuments and memorials. Today, I am visiting the ones built in memory of our presidents, Washington, Jefferson, Lincoln, and Roosevelt. I want to learn more about them. Hey, watch out!
Sorry, I did not see you.
You were not looking. You should be more careful.
I know I should be more careful, but this game is really fun.
What kind of game?
What kind of game do you think the man who bumped into Anna is playing? A video game? Let's find out.
What kind of game?
You have to find things that aren't really there.
How can you find things that aren't really there?
They're in your phone, see?
I see. It's like a scavenger hunt.
That's right.
I don't have time for games. I want to learn about U.S. presidents.
Then you should play this game. When you find an American symbol, you win points and a fun fact about a U.S. president.
I have time for this game.
To play this game, people use their phones to find information. To find the information, they must go to several places in the city. When they reach a particular place, for example, a memorial or monument, the phone will show them the information they want to find about U.S. history.
How can you find things that aren't really there?
They're in your phone, see?
I see. It's like a scavenger hunt.
That's right.
We call this kind of game, where you go to several places to find things that are hidden, a scavenger hunt. It can be a lot of fun to play.
And in nature, there are animals that are scavengers, such as vultures. These large birds eat animals that have died or been killed by other animals.
And the verb scavenge, that's spelled S-C-A-V-E-N-G-E, means to look for or collect things that have been left or that are not wanted.
We have another newer expression in English to describe an activity where people scavenge in large garbage containers called dumpsters. We call this dumpster diving.
That's right. I have never been dumpster diving, but I have heard about that. Now, let's listen again to what Anna says when the man bumps into her.
Hey, watch out!
Sorry, I did not see you.
You were not looking. You should be more careful.
I know I should be more careful, but this game is really fun.
Both Anna and the man use the modal should. It is common to use the modal should to give advice or suggest that something is a good thing to do. The tone of voice we use with the word should gives the advice a positive feeling, a neutral feeling, or a negative feeling of disapproval. Let's listen to three examples.
You were not looking. You should be more careful.
I know I should be more careful. Then you should play this game.
Did you hear how each example had a different feeling or effect? The last example had a more positive feeling of encouragement.
Then you should play this game.
The first example expressed disapproval.
You should be more careful.
And the next example had a neutral tone. Not too positive and not too negative.
I know I should be more careful.
Remember that there's another way we use the modal should. We use it to express what we think will likely happen, Listen to this example.
The bus should be here in about 10 minutes.
The modal supposed to also shares the same two meanings as should. We use it to suggest correct behavior, or we use it to express what we think will likely happen. These two examples show the difference.
You're supposed to wash your hands before you cook.
The train is supposed to arrive at 3:30. You might hear people saying something different when they speak quickly. The train was supposed to arrive at 3:30, but it didn't. Here, a two-syllable word, supposed, becomes more like one syllable, supposed.
I'm Andrew Smith, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English podcast. On our website, you can download a lesson plan for Let's Learn English Lesson 25. It includes a game and other ways you can practice giving advice with the modal should. The lesson plan also includes a glossary of vocabulary from the show, as well as a quiz.
And remember that you can download a lesson plan for every episode of Let's Learn English.
Jill, there's one more modal we ought to mention from Lesson 25.
Yes, there is. We ought to mention the modal ought to.
Just like should and supposed to, ought to can suggest behavior or express the idea that something is likely to happen.
Listen to this example from Lesson 25 and see how the speaker uses the modal ought to.
What symbol are you looking for now?
I am looking for the bald eagle. That is 100 points. It should be near the Washington Monument.
This game is awesome.
You ought to buy the app right now. It's called Catch Americana.
Got it. Catch Americana. Thanks.
You can hear that the speaker makes a suggestion by using the modal ought to.
Because he is not speaking very quickly, he pronounces it like this.
You ought to buy the app right now.
You can hear him pronounce the letter T. But as we have explained in many previous episodes, remember that the pronunciation changes when we talk faster. Ought to changes to oughta. For example, listen to this short exchange between Jill and me.
Have you been to the new spy museum downtown?
No, have you?
Yeah, it's great. You ought to go.
Oughta. That makes me think of a line from a song by the American musician Billy Joel, where he says, "You oughta know by now."
Well, Andrew, I think we ought to bring this lesson of the day to a close. But first, let's ask our listeners a question. What game do you play on your phone? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or answer in the comments on YouTube.
We should also tell our listeners that they can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. They can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram.
Thanks for listening to the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.